As well as a primary school, joined together to perform the Great Southland. We practiced in our own separate groups and then we came together a month before the show and we all got together and made friends and got to know each other really well, and then we got on with the show and opening night, and it went off. It was really good.
Looked at the script and thought the script told both sides of the stories, and it was basically a story that would be good for reconciliation, and it also a story good for education as well. So that's why the AECG, the Manning Local AECG, and the reconciliation group got together on doing the production.
It just had a great storyline and there were a lot of good songs in it, and it was fun.
I thought it was a good idea because, as a teacher, I believe that attitude change occurs over a period of time, and that the fastest attitude change occurs with children rather than with adults, and that children influence their parents, the adults.
You know, we've got to grow up together and live together, so school's a good place to start.
I thought it would be a good experience, like congregating with other students from other schools, and thought it was a good way to get the message of reconciliation across to, like, people who didn't understand it.
Our first rehearsal together saw the three different high schools, which were the main core of the performers, all sitting in different segments of the hall. Actually, they wore school uniform too, so easily identifiable as being from different schools. The first school got on to do their piece and the other school sat there and laughed at them. So yeah, it was a very interesting development.
When we went there for rehearsals and everything, nobody like really talked to the other schools, but then when we like performed, everyone just started coming together and made friends.
Yeah, it was almost as if the reconciliation project of the show was secondary to getting the reconciliation project of the people involved together. We had to break down walls of between people, between different groups of people, to get the show up. And they also learnt how to relate to each other, how to depend on other people, people they didn't know, people they had to trust to get through something. They were able to do that with confidence.
This is Ganya, right? All the black fellas used to sleep in it and that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, they all made it. They made it out of bark, paper bark trees, and the sticks above the trees and that.
Yeah, this portable house, this is my house.
But they never had masking tape back then.
And now I'd like you to listen to Elisha as she plays a bit of didge. I'd like you to listen to the didge come to you. Let it wash over you. Think about the show, your role in the show. Try and slow your breathing down, calm down a bit, think about what we're going to do, how we're going to do it for ourselves tonight, okay?
really we have to look at the storyline. And of course the story of the Eora people and the arrival of the First Fleet and the things that happened there. And many people would not be aware of that story.
I think that this has given people in our community a better understanding of our history. It's not one-sided, it presents both points of view, and it doesn't do it in a confrontational way at all. It's an enjoyable play, and yet it clearly shows that there were conflicts between Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal people in 1788.
The Aboriginal side of the story comes through. Like, you can sort of feel what they're feeling and hear, touch, and sort of like, you're in their shoes, it puts you in their shoes.
Hello, I'm Karangarang. That's Karangarang. My name means maker of songs or storyteller. That's why I'm here today, to help tell you a story about the area you call Sydney and we call Eora.
I could tell you five Native American tribes without any problem. I couldn't tell you five Australian Aboriginal tribes. And I'd assume that for the greater number of the community, that's exactly the way it is. We can name a lot of Indigenous things from other countries, but we can't talk about our own Indigenous people without it becoming a threatening thing.
About both sides of the story, it's important. You got to know both sides to broaden people's minds about it.
It was important to me because I'm Aboriginal, my children are Aboriginal, but my partner isn't. And it meant that him working with us, it gave him a deeper understanding of identity and culture and what it means to us. Like, his sister came and saw the play, for example. And we talked after the production, after she'd seen it, and she asked me questions about things in it, like, oh, Jules, what is the Eora? And being able to just sort of tell her things like that and to let her know that there was something else to our history other than what she had learnt through the non-Aboriginal history that we used to be taught in schools.
To be able to give 90-odd children a central focus and to make it real, in order to make it real, it has to be a story from a real person. I can get up there and tell them about all this Koori history and it really doesn't make much difference because I'm a white Anglo-Saxon male. We have someone from the community walk in and say, instead of this is Koori history, this is my history, it became personal. When it became personal, presentation, it became real for the people involved.
Having the contact with some of the Koori adults was particularly beneficial. People like Charles Davison and Veronica in the play, also Uncle Perry, working with those people, I think really enhanced their empathy and their understanding of the culture.
A long time ago, way back in the dream time, all the Waratahs were white. Back then, the Wonga pigeon lived in the bush with her mate. They ate food from the bush and the ground. They never flew too high. They never flew above the treetops, because high in the sky was the enemy, the hawk.
In the time of Altjarinka, the dream time, the land was flat and cold. The world was empty. The rainbow serpent, she lay asleep under the ground with all her animal tribes in her belly, waiting to be born. When it was her time, she pushed up. She came up at the heart of the country, Uluru, the one white fellas called Ayers Rock. She looked around, everywhere was dark.
I felt nervous, but I also felt proud of being an Aboriginal person up there telling that kind of story. But performing, I never thought I'd actually be up there performing either. Yeah.
I always felt proud of my culture, but this just, it was better because I could show everyone.
Everybody loved the way he acted. Been a long-
3 to 4 weeks prior to the production actually being staged, there were very few Aboriginal kids involved in it. And it took a lot of encouragement for those kids to just to be part of it.
The way those kids performed was fantastic. Usually Aboriginal children laugh and giggle and make fun of everything they do, but they were so serious. That's why I was so proud of them, that they was fear and what they were doing.
It's built up their self-esteem. It's made them realise that they have got talent, as in drama, you know, like acting, because most of those kids didn't do drama before. And also it's... I think it's helped them be more proud of who they are too, about their identity, about being Aboriginal.
It's funny because Luke, when he first started off, he was dressed in the black T-shirt and the black pants. Now, yesterday, when he went to school, I said to him, Luke, aren't you taken? Have you found your black T-shirt? And he said, oh, I don't know, it's in the room there somewhere, Mum. So I went, after he went to school, all day I was worrying about this black T-shirt and his trousers, because I was worried. I said, he won't have anything to go on with. And when I gets to the back of the entertainment centre, Luke's got the lap on. Now, for Luke to get dressed up in that lap, I didn't know what was going on, you know?
Because you don't get a lot of chances to get out and like experience your own culture and that, and every chance you get, you know, you jump at it. It's all right. I like it. It's good.
I always was proud of my culture, but just gave me an opportunity to show everyone else that I was, and made me think that hope other Aboriginal people were proud of their culture as well.
Because non-Aboriginal people don't associate with Aboriginal people, I think the Aboriginal people thought they was a bit stuck up, and this play gave them the chance to find out and understand Aboriginal people.
I think there's sort of a barrier, like between non-Koori people and Koori people, and it's mainly because they don't understand each other. I mean, that's racial tension, and that comes from fear, and fear comes from what you don't know.
One time, Pemulwuy was shot and taken to jail. They put chains on his arms and legs and a guard outside his door. He stayed there for 2 days, and on the third day he was gone, and nobody ever knew how he escaped. Pemulwuy was a clever fellow.
Go hunting man, the best in all the land. Clever, so they say, don't you mess with Pemulwuy, you would never get away from him.
It's a great experience for non-Aboriginal people to work with Aboriginal people and learn about them and how, you know, that they're not that much different from us. I mean, like, they're obviously stereotyped a lot by non-Aboriginal people.
So I was fairly threatened by them before I got to know them, but now they're just friends.
He's a wannago man, he's a wannago warrior man, just initiated to the monks upon his shoulder. Keepers of the law, like ancestors gone before, dwelling here forevermore, we know this land.
I think we've reached non-Aboriginal people in the community that probably wouldn't have come to anything that's labelled Aboriginal education or anything like that.
I never actually realised
how badly we treated the Aboriginal peoples back in them times, and we took their land away from them, and that was, like, I never used to think of it that way.
Now get moving, all of you, that way, and make it snappy. Hey! Yeah, that's right, I'm talking to you, you black savage. You the ones been taking the tools. Yeah, that's a likely story. You people are no better than animals. I know your game. Take that, you heathen savage.
I think every time I see things like that, I think about my grandparents and my parents, you know, and what they went through, sort of thing.
We must show these lawless people, hunt them down to Botany Bay. Let not one man stand in your way.
You can't really see where people are at today if you don't look at the reasons why they are like that, you know, because people get shaped by their past, and dramatic things sort of stay in the spirit of people.
By the power vested in me, by the majesty's king, I hereby declare that an expedition be led against the natives that killed the convict McIntyre, and that no less than 7 heads be brought back to the settlement as a punishment. This is to show that the natives cannot, will not, flagrantly disobey the law.
Well, I get angry at times. Yeah. And I don't know, I get really sad in my heart. The saddening in my heart, you know, when I think about those things.
It made me think again about our history in Australia, and taking it back past before 1788. And I needed to do that.
It puts the idea to you, and for the first time in a long time, that history isn't just one-sided. It isn't the history of the victor. It's a history of what actually happened.
This country has a history of racism. It needs to be stopped, and the reconciliation process is the way to do it.
The Great Southland has really enhanced the whole process and made reconciliation, at least for our children and our teachers, much, much easier.
It gets both cultures to work together, and, you know, interaction between young people especially, because we're the ones that are going to grow up in the future.
Just see that play, how they all work together. And it was really nice, all in unity. And love, that's what it's got to be.
Put both cultures together and learn one another, you know, learn one another's culture, and that way we will join together. There's no other way.
I carried the Australian flag now, and I thought it was sort of special, the swapping of the Australian for the Aboriginal flag. I thought that was pretty touching. There's Aboriginal history in my family, so yeah, it does have a bit of meaning to it.
This is our land, you cannot dispute it. This is our land, oh, can you refute it? This is our land, you can get at our heart. This is our land, you can tear us apart. Nothing's gonna stop our dream. Nothing's gonna stop our dream.
Dream that all Australians, I think, would like to see happen, a dream about Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal people living in harmony.
Dream came true, that people came together.
Nothing's gonna stop our dream. Nothing's gonna stop our dream.
If the community wanted to put this play on, I'd say go for it. And if you're really determined that reconciliation is something you want in your community, then this is a great way to start.
Go for it, definitely go for it. It's just like lifetime opportunity, once in a lifetime sort of thing.
It was awesome. It was just the ultimate experience.
Isn't it a pity it didn't happen 200 years ago?
And I do believe it's going to come through the young. They must be going home to their parents and asking, why did this happen and why did that happen?
When I first saw it, you know, it affected me, really affected me. It really touched my heart as my culture, you know. My culture sort of, the kids, how they done it. The two cultures sort of blended in together and it really touched me, so I think it'll last a long, long time.
I believe that we need to understand where we've come from, where we are now, and to where we are going to. Because we all have a dream, we all have a vision, and nothing will stop that dream.
Let's go!